Hello and welcome to Media Monitor on the SABC News Channel, independent and impartial. Now, this is where we take a look inside the world of media, analysing the trends, the issues and the reporting of some of the week's top stories. So thanks for joining us. I'm Peter Ndoro and this is what's coming up on the show today. As we get closer and closer to the May 8 elections, the relationship between the media and politics will come into focus more and more. Political parties in the country will be wanting their messages to be heard, and the media will be one of the ways that that can happen. But the question is, are they happy with the job that the media has been doing in reporting on them? We ask some of the country's biggest political parties that question today. This past week also, South Africa marked Human Rights Day, remembering Sharpeville, the massacre of 1960. We take a look at the quality of the reporting of this event and others during the course of the year. We'll get a political party's view on that. These are just some of the stories that we'll be tackling on today's show. But first, let's take a look at what's on the front pages of your Sunday newspapers this morning. The Sunday Times is leading with a story involving the Energy Minister, Jeff Radebe. The paper says that the minister is embroiled in a mystery 14.5 billion rand oil deal in South Sudan, raising eyebrows in government circles. Apparently, Radebe is pushing for South Africa to invest in building an oil refinery and explore new oil block in that country, despite advice against it by the Central Energy Fund. Now, the City Press front page is describing what the paper sees as political meddling being behind an unprecedented battle that has erupted, that's throwing a spotlight on factions within the ANC leadership. It's alleged that the State Security Minister, Dipuo Letsatsi Duba, has lobbied the ANC's top six officials for support in her fierce fight with the party's Secretary General, Ace Magashule, who he accuses the minister of peddling information that Magashule tampered with the ANC election list. Now, the Sunday Independent has gone with a story about the embattled power utility Eskom, reporting that, according to experts, prolonged periods of load shedding could lead to job losses and a spike in service delivery protests. Now, some of which could be actually criminally induced fake delivery protests. And the Sunday Tribune is suggesting that there are election rumbles for the ANC in KwaZulu-Natal, with calls for recently arrested senior party officials to quit or face a disciplinary committee. The ANC has denied giving this ultimatum to the officials, being accused of being involved in murders. And finally, the Weekend Argus is leading with the story that describes how various teams from South Africa have answered a call for help in the aftermath of Cyclone Idai, which the government and officials are calling Africa's greatest catastrophe in decades. Teams including the military, Mercy Air and the NGO Gift of the Givers are at the forefront of assisting local authorities in the devastated port city of Beira. Right, so in an interesting twist today, my guests are helping me make sense of these stories. I'm joined by ANC spokesperson, Dakota Legoete. Thanks very much indeed for joining us, Ntate.
No, thank you very much, Mr. Ndoro, and the viewers at home.
And also to Soli Malatsi, who's the DA national spokesperson. Thanks very much for joining us.
It's a pleasure to be here.
All right. I was hoping to be joined by Mbuiseni Ndlozi, who's the spokesperson for the EFF, but he's just sent us a message saying that he's locked up in an urgent engagement. So, unfortunately, he's not going to be joining is perhaps we'll be able to get them on a future program. But we have these two gentlemen who are going to help us unpack the issue around the media. And this is a discussion that we're going to be having now, in fact. Gents, so we're getting closer and closer to the elections. And the challenges that we're facing is that you need the media. We need you as newsmakers. Over time, some people might say that this relationship has been adversarial, kind of us and them, and the political parties have said, hang on, what you've written is biased and sometimes actually downright untruthful. So I want us to unpack this from your perspective. Give us your thoughts. What is the media doing? Is it good work? Is it bad work? Where are we? Let me start with you, Ntate Legoete. Just the headlines now, the ANC features quite a lot. I suppose it's because you're the governing party. Your thoughts generally about the relationship between political parties and the media?
No, thank you very much, Peter. I think we need to appreciate one thing as the ANC, that we are the governing party. Everything we do right, it's newsworthy. Everything we do wrong, it's newsworthy. But I think with that appreciation, there's also responsibility that needs to be taken by both the media and ourselves as newsmakers. You'd know Malik Shabazz, Malcolm X, once said that the media is a powerful instrument in society. It can make something truthful to be a lie and a lie to be a truth. So any journalists, whenever they append a pen, they need to know that that pen is a bullet. It can either make or break. So that's the understanding. Yeah. And with media freedom, there comes responsibilities, because your pen can make or break somebody, or can make or break any society, or can cause even an unrest or a civil disobedience or even a coup or an anarchy. So we need to take that particular matter into concern. And that's why in our cases, the ANC, there's been a report about our Secretary General having said that he does not want white votes, which was a misrepresentation. We had to release the audio of his whole interview, and that particular matter was not there. There was another issue that affected me as an individual, that the lady who accused Comrade Zizokoto is my ex-girlfriend. I don't even know her. I've never seen her. But it's said to be my ex-girlfriend. Something which is made conspiratorial, but it was on Daily Maverick. It's the media. It's powerful.
So we'll get into those stories in more detail. I just want to start with your overall impressions, and I'm glad that you raised those issues, and we'll explore perhaps how some of these things can go wrong. Sally, let's talk to you then. Just generally, just as an opening sort of thought and remark, how do you see the relationship between the media and political parties? Is it us and them, or are we sometimes actually on the same side?
Look, I think the recognition is that the relationship will always be robust. The biggest frustration that as political communicators we have with the media is around the principle of fairness in, you know, reporting of stories and developing stories, but also fairness in providing us with the time to be able to, one, verify information that sometimes the media has through unofficial sources. Sometimes that information is not even credible. And as you go towards elections, you know, one of the things that the media underinvests on is trying to dissect the motives around specific stories. And by the time they come to seek official communication from the spokesperson, that narrative is already diluted. But we recognize that there will always be tension between, you know, political parties and the media. Our role as communicators is to make sure that we facilitate the flow of information, we provide credible information to the media, and the media has a responsibility to report on that fairly. The problem becomes when we get a sense that despite the amount of time and resources we have put into providing context to the media, the stories still don't reflect those conversations. Mm-hmm. I mean, one of the biggest frustrations we had most recently was the Sunday Times coverage of our manifesto. We spent a lot of time in the lead up to manifesto, meeting all the media houses, providing the key elements of the manifesto and the issues, because, you know, some of the unfair criticism we've heard was that, you know, you're not providing us enough. And on the day, there are time constraints to be able to dissect the stuff. But when we looked at the coverage the following day, it didn't reflect, you know, the amount of effort we had made into that. And we're not asking for any special favors. We're saying that if we put time into helping the journalists understand the dynamics and providing them with credible sources, therefore, the reporting must also reflect that. With regards to, you know, reporting on, I mean, one of the most fascinating stories for me was a report over the weekend by the Sunday Independent, which was claiming that James Self wasn't on the list for DA candidates to go back to Parliament. And that was simply because someone didn't just do the basic thing of confirming with him. He had shared, he had chaired a press conference on that particular day. So it becomes very frustrating because the consequence of that is it can create tensions internally in the organization and defocus us on our primary objective, which is to communicate our
thought. You started speaking about some papers that wrote articles, and you said that they gave you a girlfriend that you never met. And I just wonder, when you have these conversations with the publications, do they contact you before, or is it you have to get hold of them afterwards to correct stories?
No, normally what happens is that for the purpose of fair and a balanced reporting, once a story is made, you must get views from all sides. And in some instances, like the story that went to Daily Maverick, I was never consulted. I was never contacted to get my views. And equally the same on the matter of the Secretary General. It was mischievous that he said we do not want white votes. A blatant lie. The audio, we had to distribute it so that we clarify all and sundry, but it was reported, it was in the headline, and we have taken upon ourselves also to use the channels, because as the African National Congress, we are a party of liberation, we are a revolutionary party, we can't suppress the media. It can't be us who suppresses the media or who undermines the media freedom, because these are some of liberties that our leaders, our ancestors and our forebears has died for, and many has lost their life and many are still displaced up until today, and we cannot take them for granted. We dare not do such a mistake. And equally, we would want also from the side of the newsrooms and media to respect principles which are there of journalism: balance, fair, impartial, objective, ensuring that in whatever story that you make, there's credibility. Don't do it just a scoop for the sake of selling your newspaper, because you might find yourself in trouble with legal processes, because in the case of City Press, as the ANC, you are taking that particular matter to the press council, because it is decampaigning us. It can be City Press, which is not registered with the Independent Electoral Commission, that wants to decampaign us. We expect City Press to report fairly and balancedly to ensure that the ANC, just like any other party, enjoys the necessary cooperation with them, but also respect all liberties, including the press freedom.
So you've cited a number of examples, and I'm just wondering, papers are coming out and news bulletins are coming out, radio, television, 365 days in a year. Over a year, how well is the media doing? By and large, are we doing a great job in comparison to the incidents that you've mentioned?
Look, without, you know, an attempt to paint everybody with the same brush, but there's an element of clumsiness when it comes to political reporting, and that manifests itself in coverage, for instance, of internal debates in an organization, because when someone doesn't have a clear sense of what the dynamics are at play in an organization, relying on, you know, people's tweets to inform a story is giving a skewed indication of what the real developments are. And you see a lot of these towards leadership contests, for instance, in any organization, be it the DA or the ANC, or in the lead up to the elections, where there'll be lots of people who are disgruntled as a result of either being not high enough on the lists for re-election or not having made those lists at all. But overall, I think, you know, in terms of political reporting, there are seasoned reporters who very seldom make the mistakes. I think the key challenge is with, you know, the new kids on the block who are trying to break into the media scene, who might not have, one, the contacts, the internal contacts in the organizations, in different organizations, for them to be able to get a clear sense of what is the thinking of the leadership towards, for instance, you know, the leadership list in the DA. And a lot of the time what you see is, you know, the old hands have a far more firm grasp of what is happening in you know, in my case, in the DA. But a lot of the journals who don't spend a lot of time interacting with the different leaders of the organization focus on what they see on social media, try and interpret that, then seek comment, you know. And I'm not saying that every news reporting should be like a piece of analysis, but it's very important that in covering dynamics in an organization, particularly towards leadership contest, that one has a clear grasp of what are the internal dynamics at play and who are the key players in this, you know, because again, the other thing, Peter, is, and who are the credible communicators on this, you know, in this day and age, almost anyone can contact a journalist to brief them on any particular story. But again, what doesn't get scrutinized is, you know, is this source credible?
Okay.
And by the time you get to the official channels of communication, we can already tell where a story is coming from based on the nature of the comments, because we deal with these things internally on a day-to-day basis.
Okay, let me turn the table a little bit, and I'm going to start with you, Mr. Legoete. Political parties sometimes also push back and I would even say misbehave. Let's just take a look at some clips and then I want to get your thoughts on the behavior of the political parties involved and what that might mean. Let's start by hearing from your former Secretary General.
All peace-loving South Africans should not buy is city press on Sunday until they remove La Painting in their website and apologize publicly.
Passing a city press, dancing. Passing a little dopey web paper, dancing. Don't buy city press, don't buy. Don't buy city press, don't buy.
All right, so that was some time ago, but it does speak to sometimes political parties take a decision or a position on a particular newspaper, publication, broadcaster, and then they urge their supporters not to buy. Is that a good or a bad thing? Your thoughts on what we've just seen?
It's a normal and it's a weakness in human nature.
Mm.
That is only human, that when you are attacked, you need to defend.
Right.
Yeah, and that is one of the things that can lead to a poor relationship. That is as a result of a reckless reporting, of a mischievous reporting, and of misrepresentation of facts. Because once you get attacked, you have to defend yourself. And like I said, when I started, that media from Malcolm X is that it's a powerful instrument. It can make or break. It can turn a lie into a truth and a truth into a lie. So it's a matter that we can't take for granted because in our case as political animals, anything that goes against our standing and our position, it has a potential to decampaign us, deface us from the communities. And
but
the
in this instance, though, this wasn't an issue of misreporting. It was about the painting. Black artist from Cape Town, I think, had done a painting, and then there was another one, this one in particular, the Goodman Gallery one, where the party felt that their leader was insulted and therefore the paper couldn't show art.
No, I think in that particular regard, on the issue of the art, we must appreciate that somehow there was an overreach. To criticize,
but is
the
it
media.
Your decision to make? That's what I'm getting at. So, is it not for the public to decide what they want to consume or not to consume?
In our case, like I said, that we like any human nature weaknesses. When we are attacked, we have to defend, and defending might mean using any method and even methods which are uncalled for, like that particular one. To say that the newspaper must close down because it has reported somehow in a very bad way according to us in the media. And I think it's a matter that we can improve. That's why in our campaign as the election management team of the ANC, we went to a number of media houses and outlets to set up our programs, but also to tell them how we think they need to do their best, because we came also to SABC. There was a story that we were trying to bully the SABC. It was not true. We went to e-news. We met with their management and their newsroom. We went to a number of SANEF and number of media outlets to just to give them so that we we properly define our relationship in terms of the way forward. Because we appreciate also as the ANC that if you don't have a proper relation and a good rapport with the media, you might lose touch of their pace. Yeah. But equally, the media must also know that as much as they enjoy press freedom, it goes with certain responsibilities. And and we don't have a choice because our strength is our numbers.
Okay.
So if you are a newspaper or an outlet, you must also be careful that when you trample on our rights, we might also respond. And when we respond, it might look like we are undermining the freedom of the press when we are just equally wanting to punish you.
Okay, Mr. Malatsi, sometimes we struggle as the media to get hold of communicators and especially when there's an uncomfortable story for the DA, it might have been that whole period of the former mayor of Cape Town and these leadership tussles. And we struggle often to get comments or we get half comments. How do we get past that? Because you talk to us when you want to and you're very available when it's a positive story. But when it's a difficult one, sometimes we just get a statement and nobody is talking.
Look, there are two things. First, but I just want to express how I disagree with my counterpart with regards to, you know, the nature of their response to that. I think there are two things. One is... two wrongs can never make a right. You know, when people respond in that threatening nature to your media, what it does, it filters into intimidation, you know, and it may affect how some of these journalists, particularly junior journalists, then report on leadership and approach them. So I think, you know, as much as we've got like very, very strong disagreements with the media at one time, to get to the extent of making calls to, you know, not buy certain publications, I think it's reckless. And I think it's not something that should be condoned or justified. Be that as it may, there are two elements, Peter. I think during any period of difficulty, the challenge that communicators face, one, is being frequently available because you're trying to deal with one, making sure that the leadership first agrees to the position that it is. Because as communicators, we don't represent our jackets, you know, we represent the organization. But second to that is the fact that, you know, often during difficult times, it becomes like a sporadic search where journals go through other channels rather than the channel that is there for them. You know, we would never hide from, you know, any comment for difficult situations. Sometimes it may be that because the issue has legal ramifications that one cannot be extensive beyond the fact, for instance, if it concerns an ongoing disciplinary case. It might not be prudent for fairness for that case for one to get into the merits of it, and one's comment will be limited to the fact that there's an internal process that's, you know, has been established, and in the interest of fairness, we'll let that unfold and action will be determined by that. You know, the media often doesn't like that kind of thing, but we're talking about people's lives here and the impact such communication may have on the careers of those individuals. We try as humanly as possible never to shy away from being available. Sometimes it's a matter of not, you know, being as extensive in the commentary as the newsroom may wish to be, but we have a responsibility to make sure that at all times what we communicate are the facts, and it's in fairness even to individuals who might not be fair to the organization.
All right. We're going to have to take a break. When we come back, we'll explore it a little bit more, but I also want to talk about sometimes our coverage of national days and whether you feel that we're doing it and giving it justice. All right, stay with us. You're still watching Media Monitor. We'll be back right after this.
Kuruleni Artisans and Skills Training Center is a practical artisans and skills development center who equips students with the necessary knowledge and practical experience to enter the labor force as semi-skilled workers. There is a strong focus and need for skills training in specific areas like boiler making, rigging, pipe fitting, welding, CNC programming, plumbing, electrical, air conditioning and refrigeration, bricklaying, carpentry and painting at the center. Ensure your future today with the Ekurhuleni Artisans and Skills Training Center.
Momentum. We're all born with it. No matter where life takes us, momentum protects us and repairs what's been damaged. Momentum Car Insurance gives you up to 30% cash back on your premiums every year, even if you claim. SMS CAR to 42024 or speak to your financial advisor for a quote. That's why we're here for you.
Right, welcome back. You're still watching Media Monitor, and we continue our discussion now. We've got some of the spokespeople of the political parties. We've got the DA and the ANC in studio. We had invited the EFF, Mbuyiseni Ndlozi, to join us, but unfortunately he couldn't make it. He sent us a note saying that he's locked up in an urgent engagement. All right, we're going to start moving on a little bit, but just before we do that, gentlemen, so one of the things that we constantly are barraged with is you didn't cover our event, you didn't cover our, and there are 48 parties competing in this year's elections. It is impossible for us to cover 48 parties every single day. Is there a suggestion that you can give us as the media? How do we balance this? How do we make a decision? Is it based on the number of seats in Parliament equals the number of airtime, but there are new parties? Or is it based, what is it, what should it be based on so that you are happy and that we don't get phone calls saying that you guys are ignoring us? Let me start with you.
Yeah, look, when you do your reporting, do it equitably.
What does that mean?
Equitably means according to proportion of the popularity of the party, because parties are also brands. They are not just parties.
But that's based on the last election. And then there's new parties that come in and you've lost ground. What's equitable then?
What is equitable is the last results. That's scientifically what we can prove. That is before the table. Because if there are 48 parties, you can try also to increase your capacity by getting freelancers and getting everybody and cameras and everything. I don't know whether you have the capacity to get to that particular point, or even try to source freelancers to help you to cover even other events. But obviously, with what you have, you can only cover.
So you're saying in a news bulletin, more than 50% of the coverage should be ANC?
That's equitably. That's proportional to the outcome and the popular mandate of the people. Okay. We work according to the people.
DA?
Well, look, the ultimate measure of news coverage should be the newsworthiness of the story. Equity aside and all of that, I mean, it has to be newsworthy. And when we go towards election period, I think we need to measure, to take into consideration, how do we balance all these other factors? One, you know, the one point that he mentions about the election results and, you know, the size of the political parties. I think it should be one of the factors that's be considered, not, you know, the make or break factor. But you also, because we're dealing with news here, is to consider, is this actually newsworthy? Because, you know, the difficulty with what he's proposing here is that, as you correctly point out, the parties that are established in between elections will be starved of any coverage whatsoever, regardless of whether they are having newsworthy, you know, developments or not. But I think another thing that can be covered is what the IEC uses in terms of, you know, slots for TV adverts that can be considered. And then that way you'll try and, you know, strike a balance. It's always going to be tense because, one, you know, the government of the day also represents an element of the political party. So when that gets into play, you're going to have dilution of government events covered and political party events covered. And that is where we will feel a sense of injustice regarding the formula that he's proposing. But I think the ultimate measure at all times should always be what is newsworthy, okay, and what is relevant in terms of the political stature of the event and who is headlining that event. I mean, we had, you know, instances where news bulletins would cover the Secretary General of the ANC, the provincial chairperson of the ANC, and then the president, and then a state event. But we would have events where the national leader of the DA is covered, but it will be even like less than the amount of what the provincial chairperson in that regard had. And what that does is you have a saturation of different events of the same political party, even though the individuals headlining those events might not have the national stature.
All right, okay. So you're going to leave it up to us as editors to decide what's newsworthy?
Look, I think the newsroom, in all fairness, has a clear grasp of what's newsworthiness or not. But in addition to that, there are factors to consider.
But the phones are not stopping ringing.
The phones won't stop ringing if there's an element of unfairness, Peter.
We have been accused of bullying. So editorial independence is something that we want to support.
We both agree on that.
Yeah, editorial independence. So we leave it to the newsroom and to the editors to decide on what story is newsworthy or what story is
worth. So if you don't quite get to 50%, you'll forgive us?
Well, like he's complaining. In my case, I'm an incumbent in terms of government. So when a minister goes and opens a school, you can't say, you are not going to cover that minister when something good is happening.
All right.
When the president goes, he just opened a school in Moria, in ZCC Church.
But he did mention something which is interesting, because sometimes the president will go to an event. He is the president of the country, but he uses that event to start politicking for the ANC. What do we do as the media?
A president is not a public servant. It's a political animal. So it needs to be known that wherever a president is, even their president, wherever he is, he will deal with politics within the work that he does. So a leader of the party is the face of the party, and at some point he will have to communicate the policy, the principles, and all other positions of that particular party. So whether it be in government, in Western Cape, they are in charge. In whatever platform they use, they even use it for
campaigning. But the key issue here is the abuse of government platforms for political party campaigning. I mean, we've had an instance 2 years ago where the Minister of Communications went to the extent of even threatening an SABC journalist who was covering an event in there. You know, and that is where the overlap becomes very dangerous, because she was at a government event, but there was a story ongoing about the size of the office of the Minister of Communications. And that was the opportunity for the reporter to ask the minister about that story. And when an instance like that happens, here you've got a minister who's the political head of this state entity that he should provide leadership on. She goes to the extent of threatening the staff, covering a state event, and that trickles into the newsroom. Because that poor journalist, if she gets assigned or he gets assigned again to go be robust, ask difficult questions to that minister. Yeah. Unless they are very brave, they won't do that.
Quick response from you, and then we'll move on.
Yeah, look, ministers, they need to know they are shareholders in the public broadcaster. There's a board, there's an executive, there's an editor's staff here. Now, as a minister, as a shareholder, you can't make an overreach of your responsibility to even want to control a reporter at the newsroom. No, it's not done. It's wrong. It can't be promoted. It undermines editorial independence, and as the ANC, we will not support it.
Okay. All right. So that's a very definitive answer. But now I want us to move on a little bit, and I'm going to ask my guests to put on their hats as editors today, guest editors, because this past week saw Human Rights Day in South Africa, a day that is historically linked with the events of 21 March 1960 in Sharpeville, one of the oldest townships in the Vaal Triangle in Gauteng. On that day, 69 people were killed and 180 others were wounded when police fired on a peaceful crowd that had gathered in protest against the pass laws. All the political parties were out on Human Rights Day on Thursday and used the commemorations partly for election campaigning. Let's find out how the guests felt the media did in covering the day's events. So, gentlemen, we've just seen newspapers going back to 1960. Front page, it was the biggest story of the day, and different takes on that story. But we fast forward to 2019. And this is what we found when we looked at some of the newspaper coverage. And this is what we saw. Let's take a look. And so, interestingly, there were no front pages on Human Rights Day. There were editorials and think pieces inside the newspapers talking about Human Rights Day, remembering Sharpeville. And so the question I'm asking you, perhaps as editors, is your take on the media's coverage of important national days, such as Human Rights Day. Let's start with you, Mr. Legoete.
Look, the issue of our main days in our calendar, it's a matter that we don't have to start at the newsroom. It's a matter that we have to start at the classroom. in our curriculums. Because many of our people can't relate to some of the main events of our calendar days because they have not been properly educated to understand the significance, including what happened on that particular day. For instance, in our case of the Sharpeville Day, it's a day which, through a conference resolution of the ANC in 1959, was set up for the 31st of March in 1960 as a day of action against Antipas. Then the PAC in February, March of 1960, their working committee took a decision that they will do it 10 days earlier than the ANC on the 21st of March. Now, PAC invited the ANC. The ANC at that time, through our Secretary General, Comrade Dumanokwe, our late father, declined to join the PAC. But some of the members of the ANC decided individually to go and join the PAC on the 21st of March. And after that, we have what we call today the Sharpeville massacre, which there was a total abuse of the human rights. And it was at that time that the world started to focus on South Africa and on a system of governance which was purported and perpetuated by the regime at that time, where many of our people lost their lives. But that was part of the work of the liberation movements. But if it's not properly captured in our history book, in our curriculums, we will lose its significance.
So by the time we get to the newspapers, it's too late.
Yeah, so even newspapers, if they don't give a proper build-up background for you to understand what happened on that day, what led to that day, who were the participants, who were there. Like, for instance, we are not equals. I'm a party of liberation. He's a new kid on the block. So he may not have known, he may not know what happened that time. But through our political education and orientation, ideologically, we are taught. But that needs to translate into schools also for people to know, because there's no way nation and nobody in the world who can shape the future unless you know your history.
All right. Yes. All right. Okay, so I'm going to cheat a little bit and ask you, was it appropriate for political parties to be election campaigning on a national day such as Human Rights Day?
Look, I think national days like Human Rights Day, when they happen within an election year, you know, it becomes natural that we reflect on the meaning of those days in the political space that we are in. So I don't think it is inappropriate, because each and every political party in their manifesto would have an offer that speaks about how it can give more life towards the realization or fulfillment of those human rights. And I think what is important with these days is to reflect on the progress that has been made in the fulfillment of the human rights, and also to recognize areas where there are fundamental shortcomings. But going back to your point, I think what is missing in terms of reflection of coverage in the Human Rights Day is to tell the stories of the millions of South Africans who to this day do not fully enjoy their human rights, and also to reconcile those stories with the journeys that many of the families of those individuals that lost their lives on that day, their testimonies about what this day means to them, and how do they feel about the fulfillment of human rights in this day. And I think the media doesn't tell human stories a lot in reflecting the pain of the country, in reflecting in some instances, you know, where we must be fair to recognize the joys of those, you know, who lost family members during that fateful day, and how in the democratic dispensation they've been able to realize their human rights. Because we gotta be fair in covering the stories. It gets reduced to sound bites of the sexiest quotes on the day, and that in a way cheapens the significance of the day, because as he correctly points out, when you read the coverage, you don't get a sense of the depth about the magnitude of this day.
All right, so I'm going to have to push us along because of time. We're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we'll start looking at the newspapers. And it'll be interesting to hear from the political parties about stories that have been written in their name today. All of that coming up. Welcome back. You're watching Media Monitor. Time now for us to take a look at the newspapers. And we start with one of our new features, and that's getting an international view of front pages from a country on the continent. And today we go to Lusaka in Zambia. And taking us through the headlines there is freelance journalist Mutuna Chanda. Mutuna, thanks very much indeed. Welcome to the program. Uli Wanji. All right, so take us through the newspapers. What's on the front page of the Sunday Times today?
Well, on the front page of the Sunday Times is a number of stories, but one of the striking stories is the proposed electricity tariff that the National Electricity Company, ZESCO, is proposing to make. And an opposition leader is basically criticizing that particular move that is possibly going to take effect on the 1st of May. The opposition leader is basically saying that the proposed electricity tariff is outrageous in his words. And then in another newspaper, which is the Sunday Mail, there's the president, the headline story there, the president of Zambia, Edgar Lungu, is basically saying, is calling on his party members that they should give him accurate information. They should stop giving him misleading information on what is going on the ground. But also in that particular paper, there's an interesting story still on the front page, which is talking about a banned energy drink, whose downfall possibly started from Uganda. There was an energy drink manufactured in Zambia but exported to Uganda, and it was found to have a component or an ingredient that is used in Viagra. Now, it was banned in Uganda. Investigations were started in Zambia, and it has since been banned in Zambia as well.
Oh, my goodness. Okay, and then the third paper, the Sunday Nation, what's that saying?
The third paper is the Sunday Nation. The headline in that particular newspaper is talking about the energy company BP, whose assets were bought in Zambia by Zuma Energy. Then there's been an outstanding issue of retirement wages or retirement pay for those who used to work for BP. So it is talking about that particular issue that has been hanging on for about 10 years or so.
All right. And then perhaps as a final question, are Zambians interested in the South African election process? Is this something that makes its way into the media from time to time?
But not really prominently. Zambia, of course, is interested in the South African election process, given that it has a party that is over 100 years old, that is ruling, and it is quite a very dominant force. Now, Zambia and its politics are such that leading parties, apart from the United National Independence Party, which is the party that won the country's independence, have a habit of changing political parties or ruling parties from time to time. So after UNIT came the movement for multi-party democracy, which was for 20 years, and now they're into another ruling party, which is called the Patriotic Front, which won its elections in 2011 and is 8 years in power. So they sort of make a reference to the South African electoral process of how the ANC has sort of managed to keep its dominance from 1994 until now.
All right. Mutuna, we're going to have to leave it there. But thanks very much indeed for giving us an update there. That's Mutuna Chanda speaking to us from Lusaka in Zambia. And we say Zikomo Kwambiri to him. Right. Well, let's come back home now and let's take a look and see what's been happening on the Sunday papers in South Africa. And many of them carrying stories of the political parties that are represented here today. So, gentlemen, let's deep dive. The ANC, as you say, it's the People's Party, as you were suggesting earlier, and therefore it will get more coverage. So you've got a couple of headlines. Spy boss at war with Ace Magashule, and then another one, Jeff Khadebe in a dodgy deal in South Sudan. So let's start with the oil deal, South Sudan. What do you know as the party about what's going on in government with this particular story?
Look, from our side as the party, we resolved in NASREC that we'll have to look at energy mix, be it nuclear, be it independent power producers, be it a possibility of building more refineries in our country so as to ensure that we have energy security. Ministers would, in their daily work, ensure that that particular decision or resolution of conference finds expression, but it will also happen through the State of the Nation address, through the policy position that government takes from time to time. And one of it is that in our reserves in our country, in terms of oil and petroleum products, we are lagging behind. And what we saw necessary is that we must go and find out with other countries in the continent, be it South Sudan, be it Ghana, be it Angola, and be it Nigeria.
But this report is suggesting that the Central Energy Fund said, don't do it, and that he's going ahead anyway, and he's already spent something in the region of 20 million rand in what they say could be irregular expenditure. And if that's true, that must be a concern for your party.
Yes, if that's true, that will be a concern for us as the African National Congress. But so far, we have not yet officially received a report from Comrade Jeff in terms of his work. But his initiative of getting investment, of getting oil for South Africa, okay, it's a part of the work that we support as the African National
Congress. All right. So your story, one of your councillors who was cleared of sexual harassment just the other day is embroiled in a new drama that he got 1.2 million rand payoff from a shopping mall. He says, yes, I took the money, but it wasn't a bribe. How can this possibly be true?
Look, I mean, if you go into the story, you realize that the Ikurileni Council initiated a process that, you know, came to the determination that, you know, it found that there were payments that were made, and that, you know, those payments amounted to the amount of 1.2 million. I think for us as a party is that, you know, we do not condone any instances wherein political leaders could do business in, you know, councils or levels of government where they are serving, be it as opposition or not, because it just doesn't look right. It compromises ethical.
Could this be criminal in your view?
Look,
1.2 million rand, you're the councillor in that area.
Yeah.
And a mall is giving you money. Come
I
on.
Think there are two things for us as an organization. One is, you know, the gentleman has been served with, you know, a notice of suspension. Obviously, he'll have to substantiate his reasons as to why he shouldn't be suspended. But we're going to look at all the evidence that is being presented, which includes that particular report. But there's a principal issue here that the party upholds very strongly, which is not bloating the line between the state and the party, and not compromising, you know, spheres of government by doing questionable transactions with them that may, one, affect the ability of us as an opposition to hold government accountable, or organizations or even businesses that do business with the government. There we stand firmly opposed to that, and the disciplinary processes that have been initiated by the party will make such a determination.
All right, gentlemen, unfortunately we've run out of time as we always do, but I want to thank you so much indeed for coming through and sharing your thoughts with us, and let's hope this relationship is of love between the media and the political parties grows. Thank you so much.
There'll always be robust tension.
But it goes with responsibility.
Yeah.
All liberties goes with responsibility.
All right, so those are my political parties. They're still chatting about what's just happened. Yeah. Thank you very much indeed for watching Media Monitor. We'll be back again next week at the same time. In the meantime, have a great week, everybody. Take care. Bye-bye.